Hello, bonjour, and welcome to the lesson on translations. Do you know, I do some stupid stuff. A while ago, I thought, I know what I'll do. I will do a new introduction for a video, and I will do it all in French. And here is a snippet of it playing now.
Bonjour et bienvenue sur ma chaîne. Merci d'avoir pris le temps de regarder. Cette vidéo concerne la traduction avec les mathématiques. Tellement amusant à avoir. Avez-vous déjà souscrit? Non? Eh bien.
Yeah, now, really, that was just bizarre. But the great thing is, when I put it out there on internet land and Facebook, and I was so proud, this was the comment I got back from a friend of mine. Yeah, okay, well, it was a learning experience, but probably not for me. But by the sounds of things, my dreadful pronunciation and whatever else will probably go down in history and you. So, hi, thanks very much to all my friends out there who berated me for that. This is a video on a Method 3 and 4 course. Thank you so much if this is the first time you've dropped in. If you're a long-time subscriber, you know what's coming. Do me a favor. If you are new, can you just click that red arrow thingy over there in the corner? It's just so that I know that you're watching. Subscribers really do make all the difference and make me feel just a little bit loved and that I'm actually doing this for a good reason. So thank you very much. Otherwise, what are we going to deal with today? Well, basically, we're going to be dealing with translations and not the French to English or English to French or German or Mandarin or all that type of stuff. But we're going to build on the stuff you've done in methods 1 and 2. Now, I know a lot of people, particularly in my group, and that could just be down to the way that I taught it, found some of this stuff quite challenging. And the good news is that we're going to recap it again and go slightly deeper. And we're going to deal with algebra and what have you. But this is so a second bite at the cherry. But I'm saying to you now, about 2/3 of the textbook is all based on this stuff. Transformations are huge. You are going to be moving graphs left, right, center, up, down, reflecting them. My advice to you is watch this video 100 times, 1,000 times if you need to, and all the preceding videos or all the following videos, because I think it's going to probably help you massively. And if you remember this stuff, all the better. So basically, a translation is a movement of a point or a series of points in a horizontal or vertical direction. Now, language here is really, really important. When I do the questions, I'll pick that up in a second. Okay, so first things we're gonna do is we say that when we move things, we describe that as moving parallel to the x-axis or parallel to the y-axis. And again, there's very specific terminology that we need to use. So looking at this from a graphical perspective first, I've used desmos.com, great graph drawing software, by the way. And long story short, here are my two graphs. The blue one is my y equals x squared. And all I'm going to do is translate it. I'm going to move it. And so I've put into my equation y equals x plus 1 all squared. So the plus 1. And what has that plus 1 done? It has actually moved it 1 unit to the left. Now, I always think of that as counterintuitive. Yep, plus 1 you always think would actually move to the right. And in fact, it doesn't. In this situation, if you put a plus 1 inside that set of brackets, it moves one place to the left. Really, really important to notice. And you'll notice that when I put coordinates on these things, critically important. Another very important point here, ladies and gentlemen, is that you must put turning points, in x-axis intercepts, y-axis intercepts on every single one of your graphs where you can. If we now contrast that with moving 1 unit to the right, yes, there is, again, my blue graph is my original y equals x squared. Now, inside my set of brackets, I've got y equals x minus 1. And again, you think that minus 1 would move it to the left. It doesn't. It moves it to the right. Again, counterintuitive, but very much what methods is all about. Now, to throw a spanner even more into the works, when we move 1 unit in the positive direction of the y-axis, did you notice that? That language is long, but it's critically important. When we are moving 1 unit in the positive direction of the y-axis, what do we have? Again, blue graph is my original graph. This time, plus 1 actually does move my axis up, or move my graph up, or my function by 1 unit. So when it's inside the bracket, it's opposite. When it's outside the bracket, it follows the convention of what we're expecting. And likewise, what we notice is the fourth and final graph, because we can translate horizontally that way and vertically both up and down. This one here is being moved 1 unit in the negative direction of the y-axis, otherwise known as down. And so we have this minus 1 outside, which tells us it's down. And again, that minus 1 is outside of that x. It's not part of the x or the squared. It's quite separate on the end of the function. Now, there's lots of shortcuts we can use, but firstly, I want to look at the idea of using algebra here. Now, it's not automatically obvious that we can use algebra, but I promise you that sometimes it makes life much, much easier, and again, sometimes it makes it harder. These first three videos I'm going to do for this particular topic are actually sort of simplified. Combining these transformations together, the algebra stuff can actually be much, much better for you. So first things first, it's important to know that we have what we call the image and the pre-image, or the original coordinate and its image, yes? So we know that most coordinates, or all coordinates, can have some sort of x, y. What we now need to know is that when I transform, that's translate, dilate, or reflect, I'm going to end up with something with a dash, so x dashed, y dashed. So when we have a translation of 4 units to the right, and I've used shortcut here, I wouldn't use that in an actual exam. When I've used 4 units to the right and 2 units down, well, if you're moving a graph 4 units to the right, now again, put to one side at this moment in time what I've just talked about. This is sort of starting again. If I'm moving my graph 4 units to the right, then all of my x values will be 4 bigger. So we now know that all of my original coordinates, all the x values will have 4 added to them, and all the y values in this example will have 2 subtracted from them. Yeah? Now, we have here a more general idea of x, y. I don't really like those type of general equations because they get confusing, because it looks like I'm just going to add values on every time, and we don't. You need to be careful. So let's just break it down into something more simple. Let's look at one coordinate first. Find the image of the point. So we've got an original point. So my x, y is given by 3, minus 4. After a translation of 3 units in the negative direction of the x-axis, so I'm going to take 3 away from my x values, and a translation of 3 units in the positive direction of the y values, y plus 3. So what I'm saying is, here is my original, and here is my image. So because I'm going to add 3 to my x value, because I'm going to subtract 3 from my x value, this is now going to become 0, and then I'm going to add 3 to that value to give me negative 1. Now, obviously, when I have a function, I'm not going to do that to every single point. My mind would go mental. So what we want to be able to do is take the algebra for original function and turn it into an equation for my image, or that image of a function. So my advice is, watch this a couple of times. It's all in the language, really. It's all in what I say and what I do. Right, using the idea of algebraic manipulations, find the equation of the transformed graph of y equals x squared. So here's my original graph, y equals x squared, under a translation of 4 units in the positive direction of the x-axis, and translation of 2 units in the negative direction, and we'll make that of the y-axis so that it makes a lot more sense. 2 units in the negative direction. So I draw these arrows just to help me. Now, that tells me that all my coordinates, every single one of them on that function, and we'll choose just one to start with, x, y, is going to transform to x plus 4 and y minus 2. Now look at my equation. I've got y is equal to x squared. I want to try and change that to a new equation. Well, I can now define this here as x dashed and y dashed. See what's happened there? So I now know that x dashed is equal to x plus 4, and y dashed has got to be equal to y minus 2. I've just said, well, if I've got a new point, that new point for x must be x, my original point, plus 4. So what I'm now going to do is say, and this is the bit that tends to throw people, is we have an equation here in terms of x and y. I want to change it so that I get it in terms of x dashed and y dashed. How do I do that? Well, I rearrange the two equations I've just got, because I now know that x is equal to x dashed minus 4 and y is equal to y dashed plus 2. So I can now substitute these two equations here directly into my original function. And so y becomes y dashed plus 2, and x, where I see an x, it becomes x dashed minus 4, and in this situation, all squared. So be very careful that x squared has got to be squared of absolutely everything. Well, it is at this point, because I now know that this equation here is of my transform function, I don't need the dashes anymore. I can now rewrite this as y plus 2 is x minus 4 all squared, and rearranging it gives me y is equal to x minus 4 all squared minus 2. Now, you're going to say, well, that was a lot of work, and I don't disagree with you, but this is a relatively contrived and simple example. And so, as such, I'm trying to show you the process. But the key lines of working out are actually those two there, this x, y, this transformation matrix or this transformation algebra, and then writing below it x dashed and y dashed, equating them, substituting them back into my original function, and then rearranging it for y equals. Now let's just check, did we have a 4 units in the positive direction of the x-axis? Now if we go back to this previous graph here, when we wanted to go positive, so when we wanted our graph to move right, we needed to have a minus inside that bracket. And lo and behold, we have a minus inside that bracket. Outside the bracket, we wanted 2 units down. And did it move 2 units down? It did. Much respect. Love this stuff. All right, let's just do one more example because people seem to hammer away at the idea of doing examples. So I've got y is equal to x. I've got my original function here. So it's actually told me that x, y is going to be subjected to x minus 2, y plus 3. So what does that tell me? That means I'm going to move my whole graph 2 units to the left, and I'm going to move it, 2 units to the left, do it the right way for the camera, and 3 units up. But I've got my transformation there. I've got my algebra, so I'm going to write x dashed and y dashed. I'm going to equate them. So I know that x dashed is equal to x minus 2. I know that y dashed is equal to y plus 3. And why do I need to know that? Well, I've got my original equation here of y is equal to x minus 3 all squared plus 2. And I'm trying to now find a way to substitute out the x and y that I've got for the x dashed and y dashed that I need. And so I'm going to rearrange these two equations here to give me that x is equal to x dashed plus 2 and y is equal to y dashed minus 3. So substituting these in now, I have y dashed minus 3 is equal to brackets. Now x has got to be replaced with x dashed plus 2. There's my minus 3 still. And then I'm going to add 2 on there, or I would do if my little tablet would work. I don't need those dashes anymore, so I've got y minus 3 is equal to x. Well, I may as well just solve that little bit there to make life easier for me, plus 2, and then I'm going to add 3 to both sides to give me x minus 1 all squared and plus 5. There we go, a slightly more complicated example, but the same process. Now, there are such things as shortcuts, and I get very, very nervous with shortcuts. But basically, the idea is using this equation here, that the red sort of typifies it, and I'll explain. When you see an x in the function, you can actually replace it with x minus h. Now, h here is a positive movement. If you have a negative movement, you'd replace h with minus something. And as such, that would make a minus and a minus. And I'll come back to that in a second. Likewise, when you see a y, replace it with y minus k. So if you're moving things vertically or up or down, then in which situation that k is a positive movement. If you have a negative movement, you'd replace k with minus the value of k. So here's an example. Find the equation of the image of the curve function of x equals 1 over x under a translation of 2 units in the negative direction of the x-axis. So I want to go 2 units that way and 3 units in the positive direction of the y-axis. So what we now know, so let's put a 3 there. So what we now know is when I had an x, I'm now going to replace that with x minus, let's just check, make sure I've got the right letters, x minus h. Now, because we're moving 2 units in the negative direction, I'm going to replace x with x minus minus 2 or x plus 2. And what am I going to replace my y with? Well, y said y minus k, so y minus k. Well, k is a positive movement. 3 units in a positive, easy for you to say, positive direction. So I'm now going to take my original function of 1 on x, and where I see an x, I'm going to replace it straight away with x plus 2. And when I see a y, I'm going to replace it with y minus 3. Now, obviously, in this situation, we don't have a y, but we do know that f of x is the same as y. So I'm going to replace that with f of x minus 3 equals 1 on x plus 2. And so f of x is equal to 1 on x plus 2 plus 3. And there we go. That would be the equation of my image. Okay? It gets confusing when you use f of x twice, but we'll deal with it for now. Now, ladies and gentlemen, actually, there's nothing more to it than that. This was the video that explains how to use translations. This algebra stuff is freaking awesome. I'm going to do two more videos, one on dilations and one on reflections, and then we're going to sort of move on to combining it all together. Maybe the shortcuts are going to be useful to you. If you are allowed to use summary books and notes, probably write them down. But I think I'm pretty much done for this lesson. Thank you so much for watching. If you can and haven't already done so, please shout out to everybody you know. I am a very small man, very small on this image. Look, very small. And I'm trying to do a pretty big job here on my own. So having subscribers and people following is really, really helpful. I'm also on Instagram. If you can, subscribe by clicking that circle there. Otherwise, there is a video loading over there somewhere, which will be very similar level. It is great having you along for the ride. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch, and I hope it's been useful. But I think I'm done. I'll see you on the next video. This is MaffsGuru, signing off.